is to do a reading from an older book by Gayle Jackson Sloan. Her newest book out is called Let the Necessary Occur, which is absolutely another one of my favorites, but I don't have it in hard copy. I have the manuscript of it, and I just wasn't going to print it out tonight. This book, on the other hand, is the sequel to another of her widely accepted and very popular books, Saturday's Child, which is supposed to be like so handy for me to grab and show you, but of course it's not. But everybody wants the original copy of Saturday's Child, and even the remake of it, and I have both, and I don't know where they are on my shelf. Anyway, this is the story of the other sister, Zoe. I'm going to read you the back matter and then read you one of my favorite scenes out of the book. Okay. Zoe Knight certainly wouldn't argue with that. Oh, okay. Wednesday's child is full of woe. Zoe Knight certainly wouldn't argue with that. She's got more woes than the law should allow. With an ex-husband that she despises and could no longer trust, a rebellious teenage son with a hoochie in training girlfriend, and the death of a loved one, and a sister sisters who have lost their minds, can anything else go wrong? Thankfully, she has her young lover, Antonio, to lean on and help her see through it all. Zoe's certain that they know everything about each other, and he is her only joy at the moment. But can one know everything about another, even the one that you're living and sleeping with? When she gets a very nasty surprise and a serious wake-up call, things begin to spiral out of control. Follow the twists and turns of Zoe and the rest of the cast for a full-paced read that will leave you breathless. Okay, now, for some of you who haven't read this book, this could be a spoiler. I hadn't thought about that. But I think because of the age of the book, most people who are fans of Gayle Jackson Sloan have read this book. Chapter 8. Ain't this a blip? At Antonio's silent nod, Zoe felt the blood drain from her face. She could only stare at him, bug-eyed and rendered completely speechless. Suddenly, hearing the irate sound of the beeping horns, Zoe snapped back to reality and said through stiff lips that hurt to move, "I think you better pull over." She said it with hardly any mouth movement at all. Questions zigzagged and tumbled through Zoe's head, but she clamped her lips tight and kept them from spilling out over her furious lips. What she had to say could not be said in front of the innocent child, but oh, she had a lot to say. The minute the time was right. "Ebony baby, move over from the car. Move over from the car. Daddy's going to pull over," Antonio gently said with a small smile to the little girl, making Zoe's heart constrict. After Antonio pulled over, the woman, whom Zoe had previously paid little attention to, huffed over to the vehicle, and the little girl firmly in tow. Zoe briefly noted that she had a very pretty face. She was a rather large woman, not the kind of woman that she would have pictured Antonio ever being involved with. She was light brown skinned, with a ghetto fabulous elaborate hairdo. She managed to squeeze her comfortable hips into the pair of guest jeans. Her considerable hips into a pair of guest jeans, a snug-fitting first-down jacket, a turtleneck sweater that peeked out above the collar of her coat, and some slamming boots completed her outfit. Zoe was immediately pleased to see that while this woman obviously warmly decked out, the little girl was wearing what almost nothing more than a spring coat. In a flash, Zoe remembered how it had been when it was just her and the boys. She had gone without to make sure her boys had what they needed. She even shopped at the Salvation Army a time or two to get herself a warm coat, while she bought brand new coats, hats, and scarves and gloves for her boys to wear. And she had seen Sarah and Gina do the same thing. No one ever talked about it. It was just something you instinctively did to make sure your child had whatever they needed. Maybe because they saw Amanda do the same thing for them. She had worn white folks' secondhand clothes to ensure her girls had whatever they needed to be warm and look good. Zoe could never understand a woman who put herself first and her needs before before the basic fundamental needs of a child. Looking at this woman as she pranced towards the truck with the little girl shivering in the cold, Zoe felt an instant deep dislike for her. Before anyone could say anything, the woman snatched open the back door and instructed the little girl to get in before hauling her own considerable weight into the back of the Jeep, causing it to lean noticeably to one side. Dang, it's cold as heck out there. Thanks for the ride, baby. For a minute, the way you kept looking away, I thought you were just going to act like you didn't know me. Who is this, your aunt? Nah, she couldn't be. Too high yellow. Ain't nobody in your family that doggone light. No, this isn't my aunt, Antonio snapped. What the heck was she doing on this part of town? And how was he going to get out of this one? Hi, I'm Niambi. I'm his baby's mama, the obnoxious woman said, cracking her gum at the end of her sentence, extending her hand over the seat towards Zoe to look. Zoe looked at the outstretched hand with an obviously recently done talons and then looked up at the face of the woman leaning over the back seat. Zoe could have sworn this woman was smirking at her. Ignoring her hand, Zoe snapped, his what? Did you say babies as in plural? Unfazed, the woman withdrew her hand, smacked her lips, and said, oh, yeah, girl, I got 4 kids by him. This one here, Ebony, she be 5. And then there's Walter, who's 7, and Akbar, who just turned 8, and Antonio Jr. He's the one we just call Tony. He be 10, she finished proudly. And just who are you? Good question. Zoe mumbled. Where are you going, Niambi? And we're on our way somewhere, and we have to go. Yeah? Whatever, sister girl. Got in them bags. Sure smells good. We ain't had a steak sandwich in ages. Especially since I can never seem to get no money from you. Nigga, you act like you ain't never got no money. And you riding around this badass car sporting them designer stuff. Not now, Niambi. Where do you want me to drop you off? Antonio asked through clenched teeth. He refused to turn his head to look at Zoe. Without even looking her way, he knew she was beyond pissed. Daddy, I'm hungry, Ebony's small voice said from the back seat. Zoe might have been mad as heck at Antonio, but she could never stand to see a child go hungry. Reaching into the bag, she slipped from her numb fingers to rest haphazardly between her feet. She pulled out the chicken wing, and ignoring the woman, she turned around and smiled. Do you like chicken wings? At the child's eager nod and smile, she passed them back to her. But before the little girl could take the pro-offered wings, Niambi snatched them from Zoe's hand and proceeded to stuff them in her own face. Zoe didn't want to feel anything for the child, but felt an uncontrollable rage flush through her body as she watched the woman unconcernedly eat without making sure first that the little girl was fed. Turning towards Antonio, she gave him a, you better do something before I do. Look, Niambi, you're so selfish. How selfish can you be? That was for Ebony. Now give her the chicken wing before I snatch you out of this car and whip you good and whip you like you stole something. Antonio snarled, reaching to snatch the chicken from Niambi before gently giving it to Ebony. Here, baby girl, go ahead and eat. He smiled at the child before shooting a deadly look at her mother. Zoe was taken aback. She had never heard Antonio speak to anyone in that tone of voice or with those type of words. More shockingly was how ugly he sounded with Niambi 1 minute and then split second later how totally different he sounded to the little girl. It's okay. Mama can have it. I'm not that hungry, the child said, but you could see she was hungry by the way she hungrily looked at the food. That's my favorite part. And what comes next, I'm not even going to let you know right now. You're going to read it yourself. Now, this, as I said before, is drama. And I like drama with a story that's included. And this one is full of story and full of richness, and it's full of characters that could just go on and on, book after book. So I hope you enjoyed it and you pick up some of Gayle Sloan's books. They all have such rich stories and such rich descriptions of cars and houses and clothes and feelings and perfumes. And you just really get involved with her characters. So I hope you enjoyed it. Have a good evening.